أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين قدم من شاء بفضله وأخر من شاء بعدله لا يعترض عليه ذو عقل بعقله ولا يسأله مخلوق عن علة فعله هو الكريم الوهاب منشئ السحاب ومسبب الأسباب ومنزل الكتاب وخالق الناس من تراب نحمده سبحانه ونستعين به ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله تعالى من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلن تجد له وليا مرشدا وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له له الملك وله الحمد يحيي ويميت وهو على كل شيء قدير وأشهد أن محمدًا عبد الله ورسوله وصفيه من خلقه وخليله أرسله الله رحمة للعالمين فشرح به الصدور وأنار به العقول وفتح به أعينًا عميًا وآذانًا صمًا وقلوبًا غلفًا وجاهد في الله حق جهاده حتى أتاه اليقين وتركنا على المحجة البيضاء ليلها كنهارها لا يزيغ عنها إلا هالك فاللهم صل على هذا الرسول الكريم وزد وبارك عليه وعلى آله وأصحابه وأحبابه وأتباعه وعلى كل من استنى بسنته واهتدى بهديه واقتفى أثره إلى يوم الدين أما بعد فإن أصدق الحديث كتاب الله عز وجل وأحسن الهدي هدي سيدنا محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم وشر الأمور محدثاتها وكل محدثة بدعة وكل بدعة ضلالة ألا وكل ضلالة في النار بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in this verse in Surah Al Imran, O you who have attained to the call of faith, have taqwa from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as taqwa should be, and die not except on the state of Islam. ويقول جل وعلا في أواخر سورة الأحزاب, and he subhanahu wa ta'ala says at the end of Surah Al Ahzab, يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا يصلح لكم أعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم ومن يطع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما. Or you have attained to the call of faith, or you who believed have taqwa from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and speak just, يُصْلِحْ لَكُمْ أَعْمَالَكُمْ, so may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala fix your deeds, وَيَغْفِرْ لَكُمْ ذُنُوبَكُمْ, and may he forgive your sins, وَمَنْ يُطِعِ اللَّهَ وَرَسُولَهُ, and whoever obeys Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and his messenger, فَقَدْ فَازَ فَوْزًا عَظِيمًا, he will attain the ultimate success, the greatest success. So this is our Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, the ultimate success in this dunya and in the hereafter lies basically and simply in following and obeying Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and His Messenger, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the first verse of Surah Al-Mu'minun, قَدْ أَفْلَحَ الْمُؤْمِنُونَ, indeed the believers are the ones who are successful. إخواني الفضلاء, طبتم وطاب ممشاكم وتبوأت من الجنة منزلا وأسأل الله العلي القدير الذي جمعنا في هذه الساعة المباركة على محبته وطاعته أن يجمعنا مع سيد النبيين في جنته ودار كرامته إنه ولي ذلك والقادر عليه. I've just made dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala who congregated us in this blessed hour of Jum'ah in his ta'a, to congregate all of us again inshallah without a single exception with Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam at his rank in Jannah. Ameen. Amma ba'd, I was thinking about today's, what should I say today in this khutbah, and then something, today khutbah actually I decided that I will talk about something that happened to me personally a few days ago, or a couple of weeks ago, something that I saw and I thought that is something happened, and I had a lots of good learning lessons from what I saw. And I thought I would share these learned lessons with you today. But it needs a bit of in-depth thinking. All right, so please pay attention. It will be a short khutbah, because I believe in the short khutbahs. If it is short, يعني خير الكلام ما قل ودل. It will be short and memorized better than a big long khutbah. And if someone asks you after the khutbah, what was the khutbah today about? You would say, it was about half an hour. And I don't want this. I want to say that you can actually say what the khutbah was about and the lesson learned from this khutbah, inshallah. So what happened, I was in the countryside, 12 hours drive from here or so, in a town close to the Queensland borders, doing permaculture design and teaching there and studying further and doing some research. And while I was there, we're moving from this little village or this little town to the main city for Jum'ah. That was on a Friday as well. So I went to supposed to giving the khutbah there. And while we were driving, we saw this big bird carrying a mouse. And then I looked at it, said, that's my first time for me to see a big bird carrying a mouse. And then, like 1 minute later, there was another one carrying another mouse. Then 1 minute later, as we're driving, see another one carrying another mouse. So, you know, sometimes like a theme, you notice that a theme is happening. That was fine. I didn't pay too much attention to it until 2 minutes later, I found this little bird standing in the middle of the road, on the ground. And birds don't usually just stand in the middle of the roads like this. It was a black shoulder kite. It was like a type of hooks, small birds, like hooks. And he was standing just right on the middle of the road. And then the car was approaching, and the bird was still there. Approaching, was still there. And just we were only like 3 meters away or something, he started flying. And guess what? He was carrying a mouse. And he continues flying in the same direction of the car. And we were driving, and the bird is in the same direction, but he couldn't get off the ground more than like 2 or 3 meters. As we can see, just on our level of our eyesight. And he's trying to get high, but he couldn't. Only until he dropped, when he gave up, he dropped the mouse, and then only then he flew very, very high. And then subhanAllah, at this time I was thinking, and that's the topic of the khutbah today, thinking about the load. This bird couldn't fly high because of the load he's carrying. And then started the ayat of the Quran started to come about carrying loads, the wrong loads, which preventing all of us from flying high. That keeping all of us down to the earth, not for being humbled, but for being attached to the materialistic things. And only when this bird dropped off its load, it was able to fly high. So the first thing, the lesson learned, my brothers, I will start from the end. Please don't hold on to the mice. Don't hold on to the mouse. The mouse here, as I saw like this analogy, the mouse here is like all this little materialistic things in this dunya, that we are holding on to it. And like the bird, he didn't want to drop it, he just wanted the mouse. But when we drop these loads that are like the mice, we are able to fly high. So what are these ayat in the Quran? Let's examine them one by one. The first one that came to my mind was the ayah in Surah Taha. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَسَاءَ لَهُمْ يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ حِمْلًا, said that those people coming on the day of judgment, carrying their deeds on their backs, it's a load, حِمْل. You see, Allah says حِمْل. حِمْل means a load that they are carrying. And but what an ugly load. Allah says, وَسَاءَ لَهُمْ وَسَاءَ. What an ugly load it is. وَسَاءَ لَهُمْ يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ on the day of judgment, حِمْلَ. What an ugly load they are coming to the day of judgment. That they'll be coming to the day of judgment, carrying it and meeting who? The King of Kings. So it's not meeting a boss or your wife or another boss. Or it's meeting Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So this is another thing. Brothers, we are working, we are carrying things on our backs. And be careful. What sort of load you want to meet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala carrying on your back. If it is that bad load, it's bad news. Allah before this said, وَعَنَتِ الْوُجُوهُ لِلْحَيِّ الْقَيُّومِ لِلْحَيِّ الْقَيُّومِ. So on that day, وَعَنَتِ الْوُجُوهُ, the faces, you'll be looking to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala like this. You can't even, because it will be a very, very tense situation. And if you are coming with the back, with this ugly load in your back, you can't run away, you can't hide it. So before that day comes, check what is the load that you are carrying. And the other ayah that is in Surah Al-An'am, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, يَحْمِلُونَ أَوْزَارَهُمْ عَلَى ظُهُورِهِمْ أَلَا سَاءَ مَا يَزِرُونَ. So, وَيَحْمِلُونَ, again, carrying أَوْزَارَهُمْ, their bad deeds in the dunya, عَلَى ظُهُورِهِمْ, on their backs, أَلَا سَاءَ مَا يَزِرُونَ. What an ugly load as well they are coming to carry. And so on and so forth, all these ayahs started to come about the himl, about the load that we are carrying and that we are meeting Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with. And this load, my brothers, is about everything that you do day-to-day basis. In your work, with your family, with your children, with your neighbors, with your other Muslim brothers. All this, what you do, this is the load that you carry on your back. That's it. And on the second khutbah, I will talk about, or actually before the second khutbah, I'll talk about the types of loads we are carrying and what we need to drop off our back so that we can fly high. And in the second khutbah, I'll talk about what we need to do to be able to fly after we drop the loads. So the first load that we need to drop off our backs is definitely the awzar. As Allah says in Surah Al-An'am, the sins, the bad doings, the haram doings, which is through the tawbah. التَّوْبَةُ الَّتِي لَا يُقْبَلُ مَا بَعْدَهَا إِلَّا بِهَا. هذا هو تعريف لا يُقْبَلُ مَا بَعْدَهَا إِلَّا بِهَا. Is the tawbah, is the repentance, asking for forgiveness from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala from the sins, which to drop the load of sins, you have only one way, which is the tawbah. The sincere, determined tawbah with its three or four conditions. Sincere and determined intention that inshallah I will never do this again. And everyone knows himself. Every one of us knows himself. Knows what if he's cheating or lying. A brother who's a panel beater, and apologies for some of you, some panel beaters are all right, good, mashallah. But this other person was telling me, Sheikh, I can't make money without lying and cheating. If I don't lie or cheat, I will not make money. So excuse me, brother, wallah, you are so limited because you constrict yourself in a particular box where maybe everyone else is doing and you just follow. But if you try to step back, be innovative, look at the big picture, you will find ways where you can even make more money and more efficiency and productivity of this money through the barakah of the money without lying and cheating. You can put yourself in a different platform and make it your reputation. I'm trustworthy. I don't lie, I don't cheat. My word is like this. My deadlines are like this. And imagine if you get this reputation and you will be at another level. You will make money and you'll be busy. But we just need to have a more creative thinking. How can I do what I need to do? How can I make money or succeed without haram? And it's definitely Allah will never create a system that you need to be in haram to be successful. It is the other way around. Say, brother, are you happy? Are you suffice with what you're making, the money that you're making? Never enough. He needs to pay tutoring for his children. His children are not behaving well. He has marital problems. And if you look at the big picture, this is the effect of the haram. You may get extra zeros in your bank account. But what is the efficiency of this money? If you look at the picture, if you do it the other way, pleasing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and not doing the haram, the money will just get more efficient, will get more successful. Which what we really want. We don't want the figures, we want the efficiency of, or the impact of that figure. So this is number one, whatever the haram thing, and every one of us know if he's doing harams or not, and basically, you don't need to think about. You don't need to pray two rak'ahs istikhara, oh Allah, should I believe this haram thing or not? There is no istikhara in haram. There is no istikhara in fard, there is no istikhara in makruh, there is no istikhara in the sunnah and the mustahab. This is crystal clear, you don't need to think about it. Haram, leave it immediately. Not tomorrow, immediately. Make the intention now before I come to the next sentence. Make the intention now that these haram things that I'm doing, no more. Once I get out of this door, no more. And then watch the difference, my brothers. So this is the first load that we all need to drop off our backs. Then come to the next load, type of load that we also need to drop down. So we have to fly higher. Which is the load of the mubahat. All this, lots of, luxurious, permissible things, but maybe not haram, but too much of it, you are whipping the tired horse. Imagine you have a horse, and this horse is going uphill, and you keep whipping the tired horse. You and I are the tired horses. Whipped sometimes by our wives or the culture or the friends, or just keep working more. By having to, some people say the Sunday barbecue, it becomes a wajib. This is one of the wajibat, the furud, that I must have this Sunday barbecue and I must have this stainless steel, humongous, stainless steel barbecue, this stuff, man, 6 eyes and 12 eyes or whatever it is. $3,000, subhanAllah, $3,000 for a bar. I did my whole kitchen for $3,000. But then they must have it. And sometimes they go and get personal loans. And where I used to live in the hills, someone would get a personal to dig $30,000 swimming pool in his backyard. Otherwise, the friends of his wife, the other Muslim friends of his wife, will just, they will be basically bullying. Like, you don't have a swimming pool, your swimming pool is not as big as ours. Whipping the tired horse, you are laughing. But see, every one of us is doing similar things. I'm giving you the shocking examples so that we wake up. Another brother has got in Villa Vista a $3 million house. And he took another home loan to sell it and get a $6 million house because basically their friends got a $5 million Mac house and they were just the wife who they were teasing them because our house is bigger. Can you believe it? And then the poor brother has to work day and night, shifts and two jobs and just to meet this. I'm not saying it is haram to buy a $6 million house, but it leads to haram. Look, if what I'm doing is not haram, but if it's going to lead to haram, then in itself becomes haram. Al-haram in usul al-fiqh, sorry, I'll get a bit technical. Al-haram, imma haramun lidhatihi aw haramun lughayrihi. There are two types of haram. Haram lidhatihi, it's a haram because in itself is haram, like eating pork and drinking wine and lying and cheating and so on. This is haram, in itself it is haram. But there is another thing that is called haram because it is not in itself haram, but it becomes haram because of the consequences. Like for example, selling grapes. Is it halal or haram? Selling grapes is halal. But if you sell a grape to a wine factory, to a winery, becomes what, halal or haram? Becomes haram. See, so it becomes haram, not because selling grapes in itself is haram, but because it is associated or will lead to something that is haram. Right, so if I put myself in a situation, it is not haram to buy a $6 million house, absolutely not. But if it means that I will get a home loan, then definitely becomes haram. And even if you will get a home finance that is halal, whatever reason, like some of your friends, man, will partner with you and will give you the money, will lend you the money to buy it. So it's all halal. But the consequence is, because of this, I have to work two jobs and work in weekends and whip the tired horse so that I don't have any time to attend classes, to improve my tajweed. Which is more important, having a $6 million house or learning how to read the Fatiha? My brothers, 99% of the people whom I teach tajweed, they didn't know how to read the Fatiha. And I'm lenient, I'm generous in this percentage, 99% at least. نصطعين and all this, ولا الظالين نصطعين مستقيم. Can we change letters in the Quran? Can I make the ta, ta? Tell me, is it allowed for us to change letters in the Quran or not? Can I say مستقيم or it is musta? Is it ta or ta? It's ta. So if you're just changing a letter, the ta to ta, becomes, that's haram. So which is more important, to fix my tajweed or to buy $6 million? But you know, whipping the tired horse means that you will totally ignore what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, doing what pleases Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Some of it is even furud, like learning a fatiha is a fard. How many shaddas in the fatiha? You know the shadd, how many? No. See, most of people actually, no one knows. And Imam Shafi'i says, if you miss one of them in your salah, your fatiha is cancelled, nullified, and the whole salah is nullified, and the whole salah is not cancelled. So Imam is praying 40 years, and not a single time he mentioned the fatiha correctly. It is not me who is saying, it is not me who is trying to be strict or anything. This is what the Imam Ahmad and Imam Shafi'i explicitly said. Imam Malik said, you have to, if there is no way except to spend money to learn the fatiha, you have to spend the money and go learn the fatiha. If there is no other way except traveling to find a teacher who will teach you fatiha, you have to travel and learn the fatiha. Your pillar of deen. If you lose it, what else is left for you? But whipping the tired horse and being busy with making money and busy with all these permissible things, not haram, just whipping the tired horse and this horse can't do any other thing. So my brothers, this is the sec. Please simplify your life. Please simplify your life. Don't stress yourself with unnecessary lifestyle. You don't have to renovate your kitchen. You don't have to change your furniture. Do you really have to? I was one of the person who was spending $15,000 a month. I was in the corporate world and I cut 66% of my expense. Two-thirds of my expenses were cut. So I found it unnecessary. Just overdoing it. And if you visit me at my home, I don't have furniture at house. And we're much happier. Cleaning, especially I do the cleaning and in the weekend, I don't have to move the furniture and vacuum. It's now open space, just like this open space. In 5 minutes, I was able even to delegate this task to my little children, because you don't have to move the furniture. So I came down from like 5 hours a week or 4 hours a week work to zero. The kids, you know, used to run and fall on their, you know, faces and hurt themselves and rush to the hospital because they fell on the furniture and they hurt themselves or they banged their heads on. There's nothing now, no mess. And less cost. Just simplify your life. We sleep on the floor, we eat on the floor. Rasulullah sallallahu, and it is the sunnah, Rasulullah sallallahu said, قَالَ إِنَّمَا أَنَا عَبْدْ أَجْلِسْ كَمَا يَجْلِسِ الْعَبْدْ وَآكُلْ كَمَا يَأْكُلُ الْعَبْدْ. Says, I am not but a slave of Allah. I sit like a slave and I eat like a slave and I sleep like a slave. Are we better than Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? And even when you start doing this, you start to develop other qualities in your character. It is not just only saving money, which is definitely will save a lot, definitely will remove stress from yourself, but other qualities that you will build in you just by sitting on the floor and sleeping on the floor. This is the benefits of following the sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And when we started eating from the same plate, not everyone has got a dish, it makes the kids selfish. Everyone has his own plate. But now we share a big plate. And then when we started doing it, I found that the kids actually they were fighting with themselves, with each other. No, this is my part, and the elbows here, and now you are taking my. And this started to happen like for 3 months. But then slowly as we teaching them how to work together as a team, unity of the ummah, and so do I link this with how the ummah is division now? Because all of us are raised now, except illa ma rahima rabbi, on being selfish. But now eating on one big plate, now they respect each other. And the one of them even started to say, Mom, he wanted that piece of thing, but he didn't take it because maybe my brother or my sister wants, maybe my mom wants it. See? So started to think about it, started to have unity and teamwork. You know, our salah is a big exercise of teamwork, just to line up, alhamdulillah, shoulder to shoulder, feet to feet, in seconds. That's a big teamwork. This is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when He put the jama'ah, made the jama'ah almost a fard. Why is this? It's just to make our life hard? Or there is benefit for every single one of us when we fall, when we come to the jama'ah? How come we can line up and be shoulder to shoulder in the masjid, but outside we are not? This is another benefit, is a training for outside. Imam Atala Secondary says, أوجب عليك العبادة وفي الحقيقة إنما أوجب عليك مطلق السعادة. Think about this. He said, Allah has made the ibadat fard on you. Correct. But in reality, if you look more deep in it, in reality what He made fard on you is absolute success and happiness. So all this furud, the Ramadan and Salah, the Jama'ah and Wudu and Tahara and humbleness and saying the truth, all this is our furud. But in reality, this is your ultimate success and happiness. This is why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did it. Right? So in a summary, before I finish my first khutbah, drop the loads of haram. Number one, sincere tawbah. Number two, simplify your life. Don't spend too much. Don't complicate your life with luxury and this and that. Just simplify your life. You don't need that stress. You don't need to work two jobs. You don't want to enslave yourself to your boss at work. You don't need to work from 9 to 9 or from 7 to 7. For who? For what? Don't stress yourself, my brother. Just relieve that load. وَأَقُولُ قَوْلِ هَذَا وَأَسْتَغْفِرُ اللَّهَ لِي وَلَكُمْ. الحمد لله كما هدانا أن نحمد ونصلي ونسلم على أشرف الخلق سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم تسليما كثيرا. After you drop these two types of loads, my brothers, you will be ready, inshallah, to fly high. To fly high closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, where you will see things according to their reality. You see from an aeroplane, how big are the cars and the houses? Just like this. This is their actual size. But being standing here, think a house is a big thing, or cars is a big thing, or they are not. So to be able to fly high, you need two wings. A bird cannot fly with one wing or without wings. What are the two wings that after you drop the load, you'll be able to fly high, just like this little black shoulder kite did. The two wings of my brothers are, in a nutshell, al-ilm wal-amal. Learning, getting the necessary knowledge and putting this knowledge into practice. فقال العلماء علم بلا عمل وسيلة بلا غاية وعمل بلا علم جناية. علم بلا عمل وسيلة بلا غاية وعمل بلا علم جناية. He said, knowing, learning, and without putting this knowledge into practice is like a fruitless tree. Just you are going somewhere, someone is, you are going, where are you going? I don't know, I'm just going, whatever, I don't know. It's ridiculous. So you have to learn and put this knowledge in practice. وَعَمَلٌ بِلَا عِلْمٍ جِنَايَ. And working and doing without knowledge, that's a crime. Imagine if there's someone make an open heart surgery, and he's not a doctor, he didn't learn how to do this, he didn't know. Just my brother, I will do our, just fix you up, inshallah. Just come to me and I will do your, the open heart surgery for you. You will be all right. He will go to jail. That's a crime. You must be qualified first. Before you do, you must know what you are doing and why you are doing it. مَا مِنْ عَمَلٍ إِلَّا وَيُنْشُرْ لَهُ دِيوَانًا لِمَا وَكَيْفٍ. There is nothing that we do except three, except two records are immediately opened. Why and how? Why you did it? And how you did it? Did you do it on the Sunnah of Rasulullah ﷺ? And did you have the right intentions behind you doing this? Did you do it right? Because I always say, as in Muslim Aid Australia, so one of the big things that we, all of us in the team, look at, we as Muslims, we shouldn't do the right thing only. Every one of us as Muslims, we are obliged to do the right thing right. Not only the right thing, we have to do the right thing right. It's a big difference between doing the right thing and doing the right thing right. Doing the right thing is easy. That's uncontroversial. That's common sense. The million-dollar question is how to do it. So I used to consult for big companies doing strategic planning and enterprise reference architectures, etc. And I go to this big customer without mentioning name, Qantas, for example. They say, like, do you have a reference architecture? They say, yeah, we have. So can I have a look at, please? And then I look at it. It's a big book like this. Is this a reference architecture? Is this a strategic plan? Just a copy and paste of data sheets and brochures and ideas and brainstorming exercises. This is not a strategic plan. This is not a reference architecture. Do you know what is the building blocks of a strategic plan or a technology architecture? What are the building blocks? It is just they compile something and then they called it, they wrote in the cover, strategic plan or enterprise reference architecture. So they tried to do the right thing, but they did it totally wrong. And that's why it is not working. So we have to know how to do things as well. And this is what differentiates people from others. This is what makes leaders leaders. This is what makes successful people successful. It's because they are doing the right thing and they know how to do it. Right? So this is based on the right knowledge. You get the right knowledge and then you apply it. If you didn't apply it, it is like being sick and having medicine on your bedside but you never take it. Will it help? You just keep looking at the medicines, but you never take it. Or as one of the ulama said, there's a tiger just about to attack you, and you have the rifles and guns and bows and arrows and everything, but you never used it. Will it defend you? He will eat you. If you don't hold it and use it, he will eat you. This is like the knowledge. We have to take the right knowledge and we have to use it to defend ourselves, to make use of it. Right? So this is the ilm and amal in a very, very briefly. Right. So I hope, inshallah, I left something to think about for you today about dropping the two types of load and what are the two wings that we need to use to get to the next level. The status of the ummah doesn't need elaboration, doesn't need to be explained and talk about. Everyone knows our situation. And if nothing changes, nothing changes. If our youth still drinking the V drinks and energy drinks, imagine, it really hurts you. When you see a youth 20 years old or 25 or 18, and he needs to drink V and Red Bulls and mother and father and all these things to get energy. You need to drink this to get energy. What you will do when you are 35? You will be written off. Your wife will write you off straight away. if you still need these drinks to get energy, right? What you do when you are 40 or 50? Right? By age 6, we don't stop these drinks. You know, told me it's haram, Sheikh. I'm not talking about halal or haram now. Just stop it. This is one of the loads that you need to drop. Don't drink coffee. There are other ways to get energy. Halal ways and healthy ways, inshallah. And again, alhamdulillah, in Muslim Israel, we'll be teaching these workshops. Permaculture and the holistic eating and it's not organic, it's not about, yeah, it's something else, inshallah, we can talk about it in another forum. But this is how you get efficient, how you can see the reality of things about around you. And connecting it with the cleansing of the heart, the heart detox and the nafs detox, etc. so that you develop the basira. And if I see you again, let's talk. I will talk, inshallah, remind me, even if I prepared something, ask him, Sheikh, talk about the basira versus the basar. And which one we need. And why we need the basira more than anything else. As Allah says in the Quran, إِنَّهَا لَا تَعْمَ الْأَبْصَارُ وَلَكِنْ تَعْمَ الْقُلُوبُ الَّتِي فِي الصَّدُورِ. It is not the eyes that grow blind, it is the hearts within the chests. A blind person is not the one who cannot see with his eyes. Allah says, أَصْدَقُ الْقَائِلِينَ, the most truthful speech. He says, the blind person is the one who cannot see with his heart. And that's a separate topic, inshallah, that we'll talk about. أقول قولي هذا وأستغفر الله لي ولكم إني داع فأمين. اللهم صل على سيدنا محمد وعلى آل سيدنا محمد. اللهم لا تجعل لنا في هذا اليوم العظيم ذنبا إلا غفرته, ولا ميتا إلا رحمته, ولا صدرا ضيقا إلا شرحته, ولا حاجة من حوائج الدنيا لك فيها رضا لنا فيها صلاحا إلا أسرتها وقضيتها يا رب العالمين. اللهم وحد بين صفوف المسلمين وألف بين قلوب المؤمنين برحمتك يا أرحم الراحمين. اللهم كل من أراد بنا وبالإسلام والمسلمين سوءا فاجعل كيده في نحره يا رب العالمين, وكل من أراد بنا وبالإسلام والمسلمين خيرا فوفقه لكل خير. اللهم أرنا الحق حقا وارزقنا اتباعه, وأرنا الباطل باطلا وارزقنا اجتنابه, واجعلنا ممن يستمعون القول فيتبعون أحسنه, أولئك الذين هداهم الله وأولئك هم الألباب. عباد الله, إن الله يأمر بالعدل والإحسان وإيتاء ذي القربى وينهى عن الفحشاء والمنكر والبغي يعظكم لعلكم تذكرون, ولذكر الله تعالى أكبر والله يعلم ما تصنعون. وأقم الصلاة.